So, ladies and gentlemen, Tom Seeley.
Et bonjour. Good morning. I want to start this talk by thanking the organizers for inviting me, and it's been a superb meeting. I'm so grateful for all the hard work that you've done and making this possible, and also for inviting me. Let's see. I need a pointer. Here we go. And a clicker. Oops. Oh, wait, it's all in one. Great. Good. Right. So, as Dr. Bradbear explained, we're going to be looking at the topic of Darwinian beekeeping. Let's see. Bring this forward. Let's start by together identifying who these gentlemen are. Who's the fellow on the left there? Lorenzo Langstroth. And on the right? Charles R. Darwin. Very good. Very good. You might be wondering, why do I juxtapose these two gentlemen? Well, first of all, they have a lot of similarities and overlaps in their interests. You can see they were born virtually same year, 1810, 1809. They both have a lot of hair, one's on the top, one's on the bottom. And they also had some overlapping interests in the bees. For Langstroth, it was well known for the inventor of the movable frame hive. And Darwin, if you go into his book on the origin of species, you'll see he has a chapter on where he deals with some puzzles, and one of the puzzles was how the bees build their combs. How does it ever evolve that these insects can have such a wonderful instinct to build so perfectly regular combs? The most wonderful of all instincts, he called it. And they both had important insights that can help us today with our beekeeping. For Langstroth, of course, it was the concept of the movable frame hive, which we all make good use of. And for Darwin, it is the concept of evolution by natural selection, which will be the theme of my talk, can help us as beekeepers. Now let's just do a quick review of what evolution by natural selection is exactly. And it's a very simple concept. It is that you start out with a population of individuals that vary in some genetically based trait, such as disease resistance to a pesticide. So there's variation. Then there's selection. In the case of insects, that would be an exposure to the pesticide. Many of the individuals don't survive that exposure. That's the selection. And then you have a final population of individuals that are more resistant than the original population, before and after selection. And we'll see that concept really applies to helping us think about how we do our beekeeping. So how do we, in fact, apply this concept of natural selection to bees and beekeeping? Well, this concept of natural selection, and realizing that honeybees have been subject to natural selection for at least 30 million years. We have old fossils that go back, it's before Apis mellifera, it's Apis henshawi, that tell us that honeybees, very much like our honeybee today, morphologically, were here 30 million years ago, and so they've been evolving through selection for a long, long time. So we can presume that everything that colonies do when they're living on their own is done to favor their survival and reproduction, has been tuned by natural selection. I've emphasized the word everything. Oops. Yeah, here we go. Everything. The way the queen lays an egg on one end in a cell, the structure of the cell, the way the larvae are fed, precise manners, the ability of the workers to orient, load up, go out to flowers, find their way home, load the nectar into the combs and make the honey. Everything that they do has been shaped by natural selection to favor the bees' success in surviving and reproducing. That's fundamental. And what does that tell us? That tells us that the bees really are the best beekeepers. They've been learning how to do it for millions of years. And so the basic concept of Darwinian beekeeping is to allow bees to use their beekeeping skills fully. That's really what the rest of this talk is about. How we go about letting the bees use their own beekeeping skills fully. Sometimes I call it Darwinian beekeeping because I like to honor Darwin's insights, but it's also called natural beekeeping, and sometimes it's called eccentric beekeeping, and there's probably still some other names as well. But you're probably wondering, hey, wait, if we do that, if we just let the bees alone and so they live their lives naturally, aren't they all going to die from varroa? Can we really let the bees be the beekeepers? Haven't all the wild colonies been killed off by varroa so that what we're left with now is just the managed colonies in hives? Well, I pose it here as a question. Are they all gone? And some years ago, I answered that question for the area where I live and work. In 2002, I tested the belief that all the wild, i.e. untreated colonies around Ithaca, New York, have been killed off. And the answer is, no, they're not all killed off. In fact, they're now thriving. There are as many colonies living in the wild now as there were before varroa came to the area of Ithaca, New York. Let me show you the evidence that underlies that statement. And I want to point out before I do that, though, I want to stress that what I have found in the Arnott Forest near Ithaca, New York, is not unique. We know that bees can survive on their own, living on their own in Gotland Island, the Hlin Peninsula in Wales, thank you, the Ile de Bois in France, and the forests around Avignon, also in France. So, but I'm going to show you the evidence that we have for the Arnott Forest, where we know a lot about the bees living in the wild. Study location for the Arnott Forest. Well, we have to go a little bit south of where we are here in Montréal, go down to this place in New York State. It's the Arnott Forest. The forest itself has an area of 17 square kilometers, but as this picture suggests, when you're up at the top of the forest, looking out, as far as you can see, you will see more woodlands. This is an area of very poor soil for farming, and there are just thousands of square kilometers, largely covered by forest in this area, and very few beekeepers because it's not rich in forage. And this is a place where back in 1978, I was just curious about how wild colonies were living, and Cornell owns the Arnott Forest, so I went there and mapped out the colonies just to find out how abundant colonies are when they live on their own in the wild, and I found one colony per square kilometer. So that was the one place in all of North America where we had baseline data on the abundance of wild colonies. You might wonder, well, how does one locate wild colonies? Colonies are living scattered deep in forests. You go bee hunting, sometimes called bee lining. The process is quite straightforward and a great deal of fun. You go to a field where there are bees on the flowers. You catch some bees in a little contraption called a bee box. You put a comb in there with sugar syrup in it, so the bees have a wonderful food source. And then you've got them, and then they will collect forage from there, and they'll go back and forth from your feeder back to their home, and you can see the direction they're going, and you can time them, and you can track them back to their home. See what direction they fly home. That's called determining their beeline. And then step by step, you work your way back to their home. This is a little map I made of a study a few years ago with two friends who are here. You'll remember this, I'm sure. This is on the Cornell campus. We started in the garden, got the beeline established here. We knew the bees were going up in this direction, so once we had figured that out, we jumped our little feeder to here and kept moving the feeder closer and closer and closer. And at this point, the bees were only taking about 2 minutes to go off and come back, so that told us the bee tree was nearby. We went down the line. living up in this oak tree. There's nest entrances up there. That's a short bee hunt. That took about 4 hours of actual hunting. But in the Arnott Forest, it's a little longer. It takes me about a day and a half to find a bee tree. Great fun. Here's a record of what I found when I went back in 2002 and lined the bee trees in this forest. I started it, this is the outline of the forest. Green is forest land, white is areas that are old farms, and so there's still some clearings. So I started in this back corner of the forest, caught bees off flowers there, and the bees were flying away from my feeder in two directions, to the south and to the north, so I knew there were two bee trees. So the next day I found this bee tree. Once I had found that, I went back here, worked my way up north, found that bee tree. So quickly, there were two bee trees found. I went, shut down that feeding station, created a new one here. Now the bees were going in this direction, and I already knew where they were going because I'd already found their bee tree home. But some of the bees were going off in this direction. So I lined my way up to that tree, found that tree. Then I jumped over here, starting with a new bunch of bees. Now some of the bees went off towards that bee tree, which I already knew about. And some went off in this direction. And they weren't going to this tree. They were going up to another tree nearby. So I found that. Then I went here. Found this one, and then that one. And so forth. I just worked my way around the forest. I worked my way basically around the west side of the forest. I didn't have time to do the east side. But it works out, given the density you found on the eastern half of the forest, that again, it came out to one colony per square kilometer. That's 2002. And we first had varroa in our hives, first found varroa in our hives in 1994. So that was about 8 years after varroa had arrived in the area. But you know, I couldn't really be sure at first that these bees were surviving with varroa, because these bees are remote. They're far from beekeepers' hives, and it's possible, I thought it was possible, that they just hadn't gotten varroa. So what I did is I put bait hives up in the forest, like this hive up in a tree, to capture swarms. I caught 11 swarms, 11 colonies, and every colony moved into the hive carrying varroa. So the bees in the forest certainly had varroa. They did not have American foulbrood or European foulbrood, but one colony did bring along an infection with chunk. But the key thing here was that the wild colonies are infested with varroa in this forest. And yet they are surviving. So the mystery grows, or the mystery is set. How are they doing? Oh, I just wanted to, before we go on to how they're doing it and how that relates to Darwinian beekeeping, I want to share with you, because I know a number of you are interested, well, how do these populations persist? What's kind of the birth and death rate pattern that you see in the wild? Well, let's go through. What I want to do is show you an example of how colonies survive and how they reproduce in this forest. And this is based on data collected over virtually an 8-year period. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to draw a distinction between colonies that are established in this forest. Those are ones that have survived at least one winter. So they're established in their nest. They've got their nest built. And imagine that you've got 100 of those colonies in the May, before the swarming season is started. Well, if you came back in September, there would be 97 of them still alive. There's a little mortality over the summer, but very little of these established colonies. These established colonies over that summer are also making swarms, and the probability is on average of 0.87 of swarming and creating a new colony. So those established colonies over that same summertime period are creating 87 of what I call founder colonies newly founded by swarms. So at the end of the summer, instead of being 100 colonies in the forest, it's 184 colonies on average. But then there's mortality over the winter. There's 16% mortality of the established colonies, which brings their numbers next spring down to 81. And there's heavy mortality of the founder colonies, only 23%. that means there's 20 new colonies in the forest from these founder colonies. And lo and behold, what do you end up with? 101. Those are the average values of how it works out for those 7 years. So go from 100 total to 101. And one spring, 100, next spring, 101. So these colonies living in the wild, they do die, but because they're reproducing, there is a balancing now over the years, over the seasons. One thing I want to stress is there's nothing magical about the Argonne Forest. This pattern, we've studied several other forests in Pennsylvania, Massachusetts, New Hampshire, and Maine. And I know that there are wild colonies living in those forests in similar density. So there's nothing special about this Argonne Forest, except that it's owned by Cornell University. So it's safe for the bees. I know it won't get trashed. It's just an example of bees living in the right conditions for them. Now I want to switch over to, given all that as background, what is Darwinian beekeeping? And how do we do it? What's the logic of it? What are the details of it? And how do we do it? And a couple of things I want to stress at the outset. This is Darwinian beekeeping. It's not for large-scale beekeepers. This is not commercial beekeeping. This is small-scale beekeeping, mostly in the context of hobby beekeeping. And it's not for urban beekeepers because, in my experience in the cities, the density of colonies is just so high. You need the colonies to be more widely spaced. But it is an option for small-scale rural beekeepers who want to avoid chemical treatments. There's no chemical treatments in Darwinian beekeeping. And for individuals that are also satisfied with modest honey crops. As you'll see with Darwinian beekeeping, what I'm advocating is you have a basic box where the bees are living, that's their basic home, and you can put on a shallow super and get some honey if you want. Bees can handle that. Just to stress this difference, what Darwinian beekeeping is, I want to compare it to commercial beekeeping. It's like the difference between Darwinian beekeeping and commercial beekeeping is like bird watching versus poultry farming. Or having one backyard apple tree and having a commercial orchard. And so Darwinian beekeeping is about pleasure, and commercial beekeeping is basically about profit. So there is pleasure in that. I can't deny there's pleasure in making a profit, but I didn't have a profit. Any questions about sort of this is a key point, getting this point that Darwinian beekeeping is small scale hobby beekeeping where the person just doesn't expect large crops. Doesn't manage a lot of colonies.
Do you have to feed them?
You don't have to. The question is, do you have to feed them? No, that's a key thing. You're leaving them with their honey, for one thing. It's really, you could also call it let alone beekeeping. Thank you for that question. Now, a key point for understanding how Darwinian beekeeping works is this distinction between the original environment, the environment in which honeybee colonies evolved, and which is still the environment in which wild colonies live, versus current circumstances for most colonies being managed by beekeepers. This is the environment in which managed colonies live. And now what we're going to go through is, step by step, we're going to look at a comparison between original environment in which honeybees evolved to live, and the current circumstances in which they often live under beekeeping supervision. And I guess I want to stress this point again. In Darwinian beekeeping, the overall goal is to put managed colonies, insofar as possible, back into the honeybee's original environment. And I want to stress, I'm saying managed because they're going to be Darwinian beekeeping, the colonies are managed, but in a different way, in a way that lets them live in what is close to their original environment, the environment to which they're well adapted. Well, I'm going to go through about 10 points of comparison between original environment and current circumstances under a large scale or commercial beekeeping. One is that in the original environment, honeybees, before we humans stepped into their lives, colonies were, and in the wild, still are genetically adapted to their location. However, under current circumstances, where we ship queens all around the world, colonies are not generally adapted to their location. So some places they are. There are local queen breeders, for example. If I meet queens, I try to get them from Mike Palmer or Kirk Webster in Vermont, because they live in my general environment, climate. So you can do that, but in general, a lot of times there is a difference in whether the colonies are genetically adapted to their environment or not. And why is that? It's because we ship queens all over the place, at least in America. You can buy queens in the bee supply catalogs from Hawaii, for New York State, and they probably are the ultimate queen bee for Hawaii, but I don't think they're the ultimate queen bee for New York or New England or the Midwest. So that's just one example of how we take the bees out of their original environment and put them in a somewhat stressful situation under current conditions. It's just one. What's another one? Another difference. Well, in the wild, in their original environment, the colonies live widely spaced in forests often. Whereas now, in their management, they're often living close together in an apiary. It's one of my apiaries, in fact. Don't have that one now, but have it. Another difference is that in the original living conditions of honeybees, the colonies lived in small nest cabins. And when I say small, I'm going to reference it with respect to numbers of deep hive bodies. This is a histogram that shows the distribution of nest cavities of bee tree colonies that I studied. And they ranged from, there were nesting cavities whose volumes range from about 20 liters up to about 60 liters, most of them. There was one that was way out here, but most were much smaller than that. And that corresponds to the median size is about one deep, 10 frame Langstroth hive body. Even by the time you get to two deeps, you're getting off the normal distribution. Three deeps is far beyond it. However, under beekeeping conditions or current circumstances, beekeepers such as ourselves often have colonies live in supersized nest cavities, multi-story hives. So what's one of the effects of that? Well, bees living in these cavities, they swarm frequently. In these monstrous, supersized hives, they swarm rarely. And I'm still amused by this little thing from one of the bee supply catalogs here in the U.S. This is where they say this is the best and most complete wooden kit. And it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 hive bodies or supers. That's a pretty big, it's probably the best for honey production, but not the best for the bees. Another point of comparison is in the wild, in the original environment, the nest cavity walls are coated with propolis, tree resins. And to give you a sense of what the bees are doing when they're coating the wall cavities, I've scraped off the propolis in this portion of the picture. And you can see that where the propolis is, the surface is smooth and it's actually impervious to water. Whereas when you break it off, you break off that layer, you can see the wood underneath is porous and water can get in there. And that's a great combination for bacterial growth, a porous surface that's moist. Whereas in the hives, I don't have a photograph of this, but in our hives, we all know that the bees don't plaster, they do not make this thorough coating of the walls with the propolis, because they lack the stimuli, this porous surface or rough surface that triggers the propolis collection. And we now know that this propolis has antibiotic, antiseptic features, lowers immune stress, immune work by the bees, and helps them stay healthy. And as I'll talk about in a little bit, it also helps. This waterproofing not only keeps the wood dry that's underneath them, but it provides a nice surface where water can condense out in the winter and provide them with water in the winter. Here's It's another difference between the original environment and current circumstances under beekeeping management. Original environment, colonies built drone comb freely, and they produced many drones. In the wild nests that I dissected, I found that the drone comb percentage was about 15 to 20. 15 to 20% of the total comb area in the nest was devoted to drone comb. Under beekeeping management, colonies are discouraged from building drone comb, and they produce fewer drones. We do that by giving them comb foundation with just worker cells. Though there are now, of course, you can buy comb foundation with drone cells. Another difference between the original environment and current circumstances. In the original environment, the nest entrance is high off the ground. It's an average of 8.8 meters up in the Arnott Forest. That's me. There's the bees way up here. They're high up there. Now, why do you think their bees are nesting so high?
Bears.
Bears, right. Bears are a big problem in the Arnott Forest. With those bait hives I put up, I could do that. I was able to put up those bait hives for two seasons, and then some black bear figured out, oh, box and tree equals bees. So I can't do that now. I have to hang and come up with a line. Whereas in our managed situation, for our convenience, we put the nest entrance right at the bottom of the hive, just off the ground. This has a lot of effects. It affects the microclimate in which they're foraging. Sunnier and warmer high up here than down here, and it increases the safety considerably. How many people here have a bear fence around their apiary, for example? Okay. You haven't planted trees, you put your hives up in the trees. Very understandable. Okay. I got a couple more contrasts. In the original environment, colonies have diverse pollen sources. It's just lovely to go out into the Arnott Forest and see how many different colors of pollen the bees are bringing in. But sometimes under current circumstances, colonies have non-diverse pollen sources, the extreme, of course, being the almond pollination situation in California. And another one. In the original environment, there was nobody treating colonies for diseases they might contract. Current circumstances, colonies generally are treated for diseases, such as the diseases spread by varroa, the affliction of varroa. So, come back. I want to stress this point. The logic of Darwinian beekeeping is this. Insofar as possible, put managed colonies back in the honeybee's original environment, their environment to which they're evolutionarily adapted, and let colonies live more naturally. And there's a trade-off. The colonies will make less honey, but they will have better health. Less honey, more health. Okay, how do we do this? What are some of the specifics of guidelines for Darwinian beekeeping? I'll give you, I think it's about 10. First one, and fundamental, keep bees that are adapted to your location. You can do this in several different ways. You can rear queens from your best survivor colonies, and I'll come back to that later at the end of this talk, about the beauty of doing that. Another way is to capture swarms with bait hives in remote locations, where you're just tapping into the wild population if you're in a place where there are wild areas with wild colonies. Or purchase queens from a queen breeder who produces locally adapted queens. And that's what I do when I go to the folks up in Vermont, like Palmer or Webster. Here's how I like to use the bait hive approach when I can, because it's freebies. And this is not rocket science. This is, and it's pretty humble activity. I just, oops, slow writer on this control system. this is what my bait hives looks like. What is it? It's an old six-frame nuke box. Dave DeJean, you'll appreciate this. These are ones I got from Roger Morse back in the 70s. Six-frame nuke box, still going strong. I put six combs in it. I stick it, this is on top of an old abandoned hive in a bee yard. Not mine, I just found it. And I just put the hive there. And you notice it's not 5 meters up in the tree. I've graduated to putting my bait hives down at lower levels, off the ground, but not high up. And I put it out, the bees move in, and what do I get? I come back, and I find the bees have moved in. There's a getting something for free, and you're going out into nature, and it's just a wonderful, pleasant way to be part of it, you know, a bee adder. One thing I want to stress, a lot of times people say that these wild bees you catch are very defensive. That's not been my experience at all. You have gentle bees, they make strong colonies, little or no trouble. These are good bees. Why are they good bees? Because the lousy bees don't make it when they're on their own. So you're tapping into a population of bees that have gone through selection. Second feature, a guideline for Darwinian beekeeping is to house your colonies in small hives. I'm advocating one deep 10-frame hive body and optionally one shallow super over a queen excluder. So this gives you some honey you can extract. Honey's delicious. I like honey very much myself, as I'm sure you all do. Or you can produce comb honey. And I want to stress that when you do this and you withhold the varroa treatments, here's what you find out, here's what you get on your survival if you keep the colonies in a small hive, a one-story 10-frame blank straw box, versus ones that are in four. You know, this is the current management sort of plan. With no varroa treatments, the percent alive in this experiment, and these two groups were set up as paired comparisons, 83% were alive in this group after 2 years, 17% were alive in this group. And what happened in this group? They didn't, well, we'll come back to this, but they, in a nutshell, the colonies here tended not to swarm, and they, mite populations built up when the virus took off. There were two colonies, even in that situation, there were two colonies that could handle the mites. Those were good bees too. But in this situation, almost all of the colonies swarmed, and it was just the two that didn't swarm that crashed. So that's a big part. So different size hive, different swarming dynamics, different survival. Oh yeah, here's the plot of how the mite counts compared for the small and the large hives. The colonies were set up in July 2012, and then the real data collection was done the following summer, 2013. You can see in the small hives, the mite levels stayed pretty low, less than 5 mites per 300 bees. But in the large hive, they kept going up and up and up. And if you went out into October, it was way up here, and it stayed down here. So very different levels of mites and different levels of survival, and this is all without mite treatments. Third recommendation or guideline for Darwinian beekeeping, space colonies as widely as possible. In nature, we've seen that, I didn't stress that, but the average distance is about 800 meters apart in the Armagh Forest. It's separation of nearest neighbors is approximately 800 meters. Spreading out, and in this experiment, which I did, I wanted to look at the effects of spacing. So in the same general area, I set up 12 colonies in a standard, what is for our area, a standard arrangement, lining the colonies up in a row, and all the colonies were in two deep hive bodies. And then nearby, so the apiary was here, and then nearby I had a long field where I could put another 12 colonies, but they were widely spaced, or not really widely, 30 to 80 meters apart. And what did I, and again, no varroa treatments to any of these colonies. What I found was that there was much less drift of bees between colonies in this dispersed situation than in a crowded situation. There was less spread of mites between the colonies, and there was better survival colonies. And all of these colonies were untreated, and they were all headed by queens from Oliverex. I think the next slide has the actual numbers on this. Oh yeah, here we go. After 2 years, in the crowded colonies, zero were alive, but 5 were alive over here after 2 years. And the following spring, take it to the third year, there were 4 still alive over here. So, and what happened over here, in this situation, there was a strong mite bomb phenomenon among the crowded colonies, but there was less among the dispersed ones. And what do I mean by mite bomb? I put it in quotes, because it's not like the mites are exploding out of those colonies, but when a colony collapses in this situation, working with David Peck, we looked at this closely. What happens is the colony that's collapsing, it loses its ability to guard itself. robbers come in from nearby hives, they load up on the honey, and the mites pile onto them, and they, unless they get brought back to the robbing colony's hive. So a lot of mite bomb situated problems are robbing and drifting of mites, or not drifting, but transporting mites in this situation. But many of these, and there were a few colonies over here that got into that same game, and they didn't do well, but there were some that didn't, and those are the ones that survived. So, in the wild, there's probably some selection against robbing, I would guess. Fourth suggestion for guideline: line your hives with propolis collection screens or build them of unfinished lumber. This is to encourage the bees to build that propolis envelope. And as I mentioned earlier, this propolis envelope functions as a waterproofing material. See in a second why that's so valuable. It's not keeping water out, it's actually keeping water in. That may seem odd, but I'll explain. And it also has the beautiful work of Marla Spivak and her students has shown, because it forms antimicrobial shroud. I love that term, Marla, antimicrobial shroud. And Marla's work has been, work in her lab has shown just how effective that is in helping the bees fight off. Fifth guideline, provide your most resilient, your lowest mite count colonies with 10 to 20% drone comb. And what's the purpose of that? It's to promote the genetic success of your best colonies. Those are the ones that are showing you. They know what they've got the goods. Help them and spread them through your drones. Sixth suggestion or guideline, keep the nest structure intact. When I was taught beekeeping, we were told to spread out to break up the brood nest so prevent swarming and things like that. But now I understand that it's better for the bees to put each frame back in its original location with its original orientation, no reversing of brood boxes. All of that stuff is just breaking up this nest the bees have carefully organized. So hands off if you want to be a Darwinian beekeeper. Seventh point, provide only a small entrance at the bottom. Bees plug the top openings with propolis. You see that with your own hives. And I also recommend adding a styrofoam board above the inner cover. I use a small entrance and I put a mouse screen over it when it's down low. Now, something I want to stress here is that no top entrance, and this relates to what I was just showing. And this is, I know everybody's taught to use a top entrance for ventilation. But we're learning about this. And one of the things we're learning is that when you give the bees a top entrance, you're letting the heat out. This is work done by Derek Mitchell in the UK, where he's looking at this very carefully. He's an engineer, looks at this stuff with an engineer's eyes very precisely. And this shows you the thermal profile inside the nest cavity of a well-insulated hive without a top entrance. And there's a warm pocket up here. And that's where the bees are in the winter, in that warm pocket. And because it's so warm up there, there's no condensation on the surfaces. They're not cold enough to condense the water. The water condenses low below the cluster. But if there's a top entrance, the heat goes out, and the bees are colder, they have to cluster, they burn through more food, and so you give them problems. And the reason you want some condensation in the hive is that bees do need water in the winter, especially when they're starting to rear their brood. And I have observed that sometimes bees are extremely thirsty in the winter, and if it's not, if you give them the normal arrangement of a hive. They're trying to rear brood, they need water. But in the Darwinian beekeeping approach, they get their water from inside their hive. So one of the things we're learning now is we need to really give our hives better insulation than we have in the past. Eighth suggestion or guideline, do not disturb colonies in winter. No checking, no stimulant feeding, no pollen patties, because we know that even a brief removal of the lid causes the winter cluster to raise its temperature in alarm for several hours. So that's a stress. I don't know how big a stress it is, but it is a stress on the colonies to go into them in the middle of the winter. And here's the biggest one. Refrain from treating your colonies for varroa. This requires super diligent beekeeping. Darwinian beekeeping is not let alone beekeeping. It's work lightly with your bees, but not let them alone. In particular, you have to keep on top of the varroa levels. You have to monitor the mite levels, mites per 100 bees. If the mite level gets high, then I suggest you either euthanize the colony, we can talk about how to do that, or treat the colony for varroa and requeen it with a queen from a better source. And by doing these two things, eliminating the colonies that don't have where the varroa levels are getting too high, you eliminate your non-resistant colonies and you avoid producing these robbing attractive colonies which spread their whereby their mites get spread. Come back to sort of the key point. What is the survival pattern of this Darwinian beekeeping? Well, it's almost identical to what I see in the woods. For 2010 to 2017, followed 10 to 12 colonies that I kept with Darwinian beekeeping at various locations, by a barn, out by a meadow, other places. Summer survival of these Darwinian beekeeping kept colonies is 97%. Winter survival was 84%. Overall, 82% survival for an entire year. No treatments. So we know that Darwinian beekeeping works in Ithaca, New York. This is a place with virtually no commercial beekeeping, but lots of forests with wild colonies. So it has a lot going for it. But what if you don't have those conditions? Well, one can also foster natural selection to get varroa-resistant colonies. And here I want to refer you to this wonderful paper by Jared Blockher, Peter Neumann, and others. It's called Darwinian Black Box Selection for Resistance to Settled Invasive Varroa Destructor Parasites in Honeybees. And what they do in this paper, this is an open access paper, so just Google that, their names or the names of Jared or Peter, or just Google Darwinian Black Box Selection, actually. It'll bring up this paper, open access, you can read it. And basically what they provide is a detailed program of selection for colonies that will work well with Darwinian beekeeping. And this is how it works. You just basically set up some colonies, they say start with 25 to 30 genetically diverse colonies, get a location that's as remote as possible, so your queens, when you have virgin queens that mate, they'll tap into hopefully some wild colonies. Don't use any varroa destructor control, and just keep going for several years, letting colonies die under varroa, but then breeding from the survivors. And by breeding, it's not fancy breeding where you have to graft or anything like that. It's you split up your survivors in ways that they describe. So they do emergency queen rearing, and then you rebuild your numbers. It takes about 4 years, apparently. So just to conclude, I want to have our bee here thank Charles Darwin for his guidance on beekeeping. And also to point out to you that if you're intrigued by the story that I've been telling you, I spent about 18 months writing a book called The Lives of Bees, and you can read more about it if you'd like. The Lives of Bees, and it's the heart of this book is I'm telling the story of the honeybee in the wild. So I'm not sure where we stand in the time, but that's as much as I want to present now. But I hope that leaves us time for questions. Yes?
Shameless promotion, but you'll be in our area November 11th in Charleston, South Carolina. Looking forward to seeing both you and Dr. Seeley and Dr. Sharashkin will be with us. So looking forward to that.
Good.
My question, must you use a queen excluder? I prefer not to.
You don't need to. This is if you want to put a shallow super to get some honey. You don't have to. I recommend it because I find it more convenient to not have to separate. Keep the queen out of the honey super, so I can. So it means when I take the honey super off, I'm not messing up the brood nest.
Thanks so much.
And did Charleston make it through the hurricane okay?
We escaped before. I'm not sure.
Okay.
Perhaps I think we're okay.
Yes.
Good morning.
Oh, good morning. How are you?
My shameless production, you'll be at Massachusetts Beekeepers Association on March 14th, 2020.
Glad it's not November. It's been a while. Thank you.
I look forward to seeing you there. My question is whether you've looked at the quality of queens. You seem to be using grafted and cultivated queens rather than letting the bees make their own. Why is that, and what's the difference in quality?
Oh, I'm not using grafted queens at all. I'm getting my queens by catching wild swarms with bait hives, and then I would make a split from colonies that are survivors. And I specifically don't graft. I'm really glad you raised this point, because when we graft, we're choosing which larvae to rear queens from. I think the bees know better than we do which are the right larvae to use for the queens. So I'm specifically avoiding grafting. So I'm just splitting a colony and having a new emergency queen there.
Okay, you referred to buying queens, and I assume those are all grafted.
That's true. That's right. If you buy queens, then you would probably be getting queens that are grafted. You almost certainly would be getting grafted queens. Yeah.
Okay, so you're finding that the queens that you buy are equal to quality, and the ones that
That's a really good question. I have never compared them. Sometimes I have to buy queens if I want to set up an experiment in the spring. I just need the queens to start in late April or early May. I can't do that with emergency queen here.
Thanks.
You're welcome. Thank you for questions.
Hi, Tom. I love what you say, and I love what you write, and I try and follow what you say. I think I love my bees and I'm trying to take care of them. I'm also trying to beekeep within agriculture,
yeah,
and it's killing my bees. And before I go home today,
yeah,
do you have any hope or a way, or is this delusional? Should I just quit? And
that's a really good question. I don't have a good answer, but all I can say is, yeah, if you're in a place where there's a lot of pesticides, that's really hard on bees. And I don't have a, I'm afraid I don't have an answer to that will help you. The bees do better because they're just in a polluted environment. Yeah. I'm sorry. Yeah.
Okay, well, I'm going to continue trying as many of your principles as I can. So thank you.
I don't know. Does anybody have a suggestion for what to do with that situation? It's just the whole environment is so.
Change the
agricultural
model.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, that is the broad scale solution. I was thinking of something a little more.
Thank you.
Yeah, and right, you have, yeah, these pesticides affect the queen quality too.
Well, we've got questions here as well.
Yeah, the suggestion is to rotate the combs out frequently. The problem is the pollen, the basic food that they're collecting ongoing is contaminated. Next question.
Yes, I'm from Northern Ontario. I own the beekeeping on reservations. My question is on the upcoming Anthropocene, the 60s extinction.
Yes.
What is your opinion on the chances of the bees surviving?
Question is, what's my take on the chances of bees surviving the Anthropocene, or the global temperatures are going to be going up and are lots of changes in the world? I'm actually optimistic for the bees because they have they've been around a long time. They've been through a lot of heatings and coolings, and they have a remarkable thing. Dave Tarkin, correct me if I'm wrong on this, but I believe the honeybees have the highest known recombination rate of any metazoan organism. So they really have skill at generating genetic variation from generation to generation. So that's kind of like an insurance policy for them to come up with genetic variants that will enable them to change to a changing world.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm coming from Europe, from Romania.
Yes.
I try to figure out what we can. The commercial beekeeper, what can learn from this presentation. And at least from my point of view, I take home the idea that having the wooden walls of the hives covered in propolis would have a benefic effect on the general state of health of the bees. But technical question. Do you think this could be applied for commercial beekeeping?
Yes, that could be applied to commercial beekeepers. And certainly improving the insulation would be relevant for commercial beekeepers. Maybe not the migratory beekeepers that need to have their move hives around, but both of those things, because we build those hives, so those are completely under our control.
And the second question regarding this propolis film, is it like with wax, we have to encourage the bees to replace it from time to time, or it last indefinitely?
Yeah, the question is, do we have to encourage replacement? We have to scrape off the propolis to get turnover. I don't think so. I don't think it really, given its chemical composition, I don't think it's quite as much of a sponge. It's not as wax is. But I might be wrong about that. I'll have to ask Marla whether she has a take on that.
And the last question, regarding the necessity of having a very, for having the water taken from the colony. Do you think that meshed bottle boards are hermetic from this point of view?
Oh, the question is, yeah, the screened bottom board, how does that affect this idea of letting the bees use the condensate in the winter as a water source? I don't know. My hunch would be it probably does not mess that up, because a lot of the condensation is on the walls and on the floor, so I think they would still have poop driblets of water to inside the hive as a winter water source.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you for your questions. I'll do another one here because I had neglected this.
Good morning. I'm coming from Alberta. I have a question about keeping the bees for the winter. In Alberta, we have kind of dry and cold winters.
Yes.
And you mentioned that exit openings should be just only in the lower part of the hive. And I'm actually interested how you derive this statement. And in your research, in the wild bees population on the trees, when you found the tree hive, did you find this opening is above the nest or below the nest?
Yeah, thank you for asking that question. We're in nature, where in the natural nest, where were the entrances? They were generally in the lower third of the tree cavity. And the first part of your question was, how does this work in how does having this low entrance and then having water collecting inside the nest work in your environment? I can't really say. It's something you're going to have to test, because I know you have extreme cold there. But I do know that in principle, and it's just inevitable, if the colony bees are living in a well-insulated cavity and there's not a top entrance, not a hole in the lid, they're going to have a larger and warmer pocket. The evidence is that even in extreme cold, if they're living in a hive that's well insulated without a top entrance, they're not even in a tight cluster. They're able to even move around, even in the deepest of cold, when the hive is well insulated and does not have a hole in the ceiling.
Thank you.
Yes.
Good morning. So I'm from Worcester County, which of course you know well. That's is the Boston area in Massachusetts, U.S.
Yep.
We've been taught, I'm a seven-year beekeeper, we've been taught to feed during the winter and continually feed. We've discouraged opening the hives. We put sugar candy in to accommodate it. I seem to have very fussy eaters. They don't like to load up with the syrup late in the fall. So I've had dead outs of the strongest hive even last year. You're discouraging us from opening the hives during the winter. I don't know how to get past that unless I just want to play Russian roulette. What's your input on that?
Well, in some sense, you do want to play Russian roulette, but in this...
Excuse the Russian people in the room.
Okay, right. We're going to play poker on the bees. I'd have to know the particulars of your situation. I would, for example, would like to know whether the colonies that are dying are starving, or whether there's something else going on, like mites are killing those colonies.
Yeah, in one particular case, there was the strongest colony and starved, and was confirmed by people that are smarter than me.
Well, in my experience, that if the colony, and when you keep a colony, as I do, in these single-story deeps, they've got that whole box plugged with honey, sometimes as early as late August, and that is more than enough honey for them to get through the winter. So I don't know
these
how much...
These are double deeps.
Yeah. No, mine are single deeps. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And some of that is may have to do with the difference between you may be running a large colony, as is typical in a commercial sort of situation, a bigger colony that goes through more food. All I can say is that in this situation, where it's a smaller colony, and they've got their nest all organized, nice and tight, the food's just where they want it, pollen arranged properly, they will go through, and especially if the hive is insulated. The work that is coming out now is showing that if the colony is just living in a thin-walled hive, they'll go through 20 kilograms or 60 pounds of honey. But if it's a well-insulated hive, they're burning about a third that much honey to get through winter. The insulation is probably the biggest boo-boo we have made as beekeepers.
I've stopped insulating, so perhaps that's it.
Oh, yeah.
Dum-dum-dum.
Yeah. Okay. Well,
except for at the top. Yeah. Homosode goes in the top, but no rack.
Yeah, homosode's sort of okay. It's marginal as an insulation, too.
So not to prolong this, the propolis lining that you talk about, I don't know how to instruct the bees to line the interior with propolis.
You have to stimulate them to do that by giving them a rough surface, either on these propolis collection screens, which are sold by the bee supply places, or just rough them up that surface, the interior surface.
Thank you.
You're welcome. How are we doing for time? Two more minutes. One question.
You know that you said that your hives in the woods had 100% were infected by varroa.
Yes.
I just wondered whether you might know something about, so that would normally be an alarming situation. So how do the varroa carry on multiplying so they don't end up dripping with varroa? So
yeah, I do think. Yeah.
Do you have some idea about how they keep the levels sort of manageable? They obviously don't get people.
I do. And David Peck here gave a talk on that yesterday, and I'll try to summarize it. The bees are, and I didn't mention it here at all, the bees are, have a number of mechanisms whereby they're controlling the varroa in their colonies. They're good at biting off the legs of the varroa. They're good at opening up the cells in which that are infested with varroa and recapping them. But what's the third thing, David, that they're good at?
They're recapping hygienic.
Yeah, and they're they're uncapping, recapping, they're hygienic, which is just pulling out the infected pupa, and they're also good at grooming the mites, biting the mites. And those are the traits that's what natural selection has provided us with. We didn't breed them, they've got those because the bees with those are the ones that are persistent.
Thank you. I'm sorry I missed that talk.
Yeah. We'll drop me an email and we'll get you the rep. We'll get you the information. Time's up. Okay.